One skill researchers and educators agree critical thinkers should possess in practice is the ability to look at a problem from different perspectives. Success in evaluating ethical issues requires consideration of multiple perspectives. Let's take time to consider a few tools we might add to our frameworks to make us better thinkers. These tools, along with the ethical perspectives I shared previously, will help you lay a foundation for your own framework for working with digital media issues. We are not born as experts in most disciplines. Critical thinking is no exception to that maxim. We need to learn how to become critical thinkers, and we need to practice the skills we've learned. With critical thinking, let's begin by finding a shared starting point through establishing common terms and definitions used in critical thinking circles. In his text, Critical Thinking, Jonathan Haber lays out the components of structured thinking and logical arguments. Haber suggests the reasons we look for methods for structured thinking are to make clear what we or others are thinking or communicating, make transparent the reasons behind what we believe or want others to believe, and can determine if they justify reasons for belief. Structured thinking involves using common terms and diagrams to construct and break down arguments. While the field of critical thinking is vast, we can use these definitions and diagramming techniques to help us with digital media ethical issues. 7 common terms we might consider are argument, premise, conclusion, inference, logical form, validity, and soundness. We can apply logical principles to our everyday communication using these expressions. An argument is a statement or statements providing evidence for a conclusion. For example, I might argue that Facebook is a poor source for news and conclude that people should not read Facebook for news. In this example, Facebook is a poor source for the news is my argument, and people should not read Facebook for news is my conclusion. While my Facebook example has only one statement in its argument, an argument may have multiple statements. A premise is a statement of evidence for an argument. We may compose an argument through the use of multiple and structured premises. In my Facebook example, I might consider adding a statement, premise, to strengthen the argument. Perhaps I might say, Facebook spreads fake news faster than any other social website, according to researchers at Princeton University. A conclusion is a declaration accepted as true if we accept the premises presented in the argument to be true. In our example, the conclusion is people should not read Facebook for news. The argument with its premises leads us to a conclusion. The steps in the argument, the premises, and their presentation are the inference. Consider the inference as the structure of the argument with all its components and presentation. Often expressed symbolically, the logical form is the abstract structure of the argument. Here is an example of a generic logical form for a logical argument. Looking at a diagram of the structure can make it easier to understand its form. If we accept the premises in an argument as true, we cannot declare the conclusion false. We categorize the validity of an argument based on this point. Validity is the term we used to assess arguments. Finally, we deem sound an argument with true premises and valid logical form. We also use the term soundness to evaluate arguments. While still on the subject of baseline terms and definitions, let's consider reasoning. Experts suggest 2 types of arguments used when reasoning: deductive arguments and inductive arguments. Deductive arguments are self-contained in that the argument holds everything one needs to accept the conclusion. Deductive arguments are also valid and sound in that one must accept the conclusion if the premises are true and of valid form. Inductive arguments are likely to be true and tested based on the strength and weaknesses of the argument. Jonathan Haber suggests Many, if not most, of the arguments we are exposed to in everyday life are inductive rather than deductive. Holding an understanding of these key terms will help us better decipher arguments and diagrams. Like the ethical perspectives and terms such as empathy and stakeholder, consider adding these unfamiliar terms to your lexicon and framework. Now that we've identified key terms for our critical thinking process, let's consider a couple tools which can plan or break down arguments into smaller chunks. As a creation of the famous philosopher Aristotle, the syllogism, as this form of reasoning is known, is the first formal system of logic ever devised, and it remained the basic model for logic up until the 19th century. The syllogism comprises three pieces, two premises and a conclusion. I've defined the premise and the conclusion earlier, so I won't repeat those definitions. Instead, I'll highlight the key parts of the structure of the syllogism. Aristotle held there can only be two premises leading to a conclusion. And if we accept the two premises as to be true and in valid form, we must accept the conclusion. Let's apply the Instagram example I worked through in the Ethical Perspectives lecture to the syllogism. For sake of argument, I'll declare my conclusion as: taking selfies with cell phones in dangerous areas of national parks should be prohibited. In strictly adhering to Aristotle's form of the syllogism, I will require two premises. The two things we need to suppose. I'll define premise one as: people are careless when taking selfies and put their personal safety at substantial risk in national parks. My second premise is: too many people have fallen to their death while taking selfies in national parks. If you accept my two premises as true and valid, then you must accept the conclusion and support my position of banning selfies in national parks. You might contest my premises are too vague or not providing enough evidence, so you cannot wholeheartedly accept my conclusion. This can be one drawback to using the simplest and strictest form of the syllogism. According to Jonathan Haber in Critical Thinking, another popular method of representing arguments visually was developed by British philosopher Stephen Toulmin. Rather than starting with premises leading to conclusions, Toulmin diagrams begin with grounds leading to a claim. We call the link, arrow, from grounds to the claim a warrant. The warrant provides evidence to the claim and becomes a claim for another part of the diagram with its own grounds. As you can see in this diagram, the Toulmin diagram looks similar to the syllogism diagram, but allows for flexibility in that the warrant can represent support to a claim and be a claim itself. This visual diagramming technique allows us to fully develop our argument. Go back to our Instagram example. See how I might improve my argument using a Toulmin diagram. Rather than provide single sentence premises, I make my grounds descriptive and use a warrant to acknowledge it too can be an additional claim I'm asking you to accept. I'll pause here and ask you which technique, the syllogism or the Toulmin diagram, makes my argument convincing. An argument map is another diagramming technique to consider. In using an argument map, Jonathan Haber says, one is asked to accept the conclusion / main claim by asking if the premises presented below it answer the question. Does what appears in a box below provide reasons to believe what appears in the box above? Some premises work together and are called co-premises. This technique pulls from both the syllogism and the Toulmin techniques. Here is my Instagram argument mapped using the argument map approach. While the differences may be subtle, I offer premises 1 and 2 as tightly coupled. I pick the Facebook and Instagram examples in this exercise as an example of using critical thinking skills and techniques in the domain of social media. You may or may not agree with the premises, claims, warrants, and conclusions in these examples. I intend not to convince you of these specific declarations. Rather, I chose them as real and contemporary examples of digital media. Consider adding these resources, terms, and diagrams to our personal frameworks for the digital media ethical challenges we face. It's clear to me that we cannot use these tools alone. To seek the best answers to our dilemmas, we must include ethical perspectives and consider stakeholders. This approach will best help us to choose the best ethical actions.